It is now time for question period. The Leader of Her Majesty's Loyal Opposition.
Mr. Speaker, my question is for the Premier. Today, the Premier backpedaled on her reckless climate change plan. She now says she won't ban natural gas.
Order.
Every time we asked about changes to the building code,
order,
the Premier dodges and deflects. Now we're hearing of the new net zero carbon homes, which the Minister of the Environment can't even define. Mr. Speaker, it is practically impossible to heat your home without natural gas and be a net zero on emissions, unless you live in the base of a wind turbine. Knowing that, Mr. Speaker, will the Premier admit this is just liberal spin on phasing out natural gas?
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. While we were very proud, I was very proud to be with our Minister of Energy, Minister of Environment and Climate Change, Minister of Economic Development, and Minister of Transportation today, Mr. Speaker, to announce and reveal the Climate Change Action Plan, Mr. Speaker, to put more details into the public realm so that people can understand how we are going to tackle climate change, Mr. Speaker. Because on this side of the House, the discussion is not about whether we tackle climate change, Mr. Speaker. That's the discussion that's being held on the other side of the House. On this side of the House, we are tackling climate change, Mr. Speaker, and we're doing it for now and for generations to come.
Be seated, please. Be seated, please.
Thank you. Supplementary. Excuse me. Stop. Please.
Mr. Speaker, again to the Premier. Ontario's hydro rates are skyrocketing, forcing many families to turn to natural gas to heat their homes. The Premier's solution to this? Just raise natural gas prices higher than electricity. Sure, you may be able to keep a natural gas stove or barbecue, but heating your home with natural gas will no longer be an option. On top of that, Mr. Speaker, the average net zero home, according to Natural Resources Canada, can cost $150,000 more than the average home today.
Excuse me. Stop the clock. The Minister of Aboriginal Affairs, the member from Scarborough North, the Minister of Energy, come to order. Etobicoke North. Thank you.
Mr. Speaker, obviously the government doesn't like it when facts get in the way of their spin. Natural Resources Canada says that a net zero home can cost $150,000 more. So, Mr. Speaker, my question to the Premier is, where does she expect home buyers to find another $150,000?
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. I would say to the Leader of the Opposition, where does he expect any of us to find another planet to live on, Mr. Speaker?
There was a group of grade 5 students from Chester Public School at the announcement this morning, Mr. Speaker. They're all studying climate change, and they know that it is up to us to take action. So it's up to us to help homeowners and help renters reduce their emissions, Mr. Speaker, to use less energy, save more money through home energy retrofits, Mr. Speaker. It's up to us to help reduce pollution by investing in transit and electric vehicle incentives. That's what our plan does. And to support businesses and industries and manufacturers to be competitive, Mr. Speaker, and to develop the technologies that are going to reduce their carbon footprint.
Thank you. Final supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, again to the Premier. So let's recap. A new home, that's now going to cost you $150,000 more. To heat that home, it's going to cost you $3,000 more. But don't worry,
order,
the Premier assures us these costs will lead to business growth in Ontario. Well, Mr. Speaker, wrong again. The money generated from cap and trade will see businesses send, hear this, $300 million to California by 2020 and another $3 billion to California by 2030. Mr. Speaker, why does the Premier want to make life more unaffordable for families and businesses in Ontario? Everyone in this House wants to combat climate change, but no one in Ontario supports a radical, ideologically driven approach. Will you do the right thing and make Ontario more affordable?
Thank you. Be seated, please. Be seated, please.
Thank you. Premier.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. You know, Mr. Speaker, yesterday the Minister of Energy and Climate Change and I were at a green building conference. There were construction companies and developers and builders from all around the world, Mr. Speaker. There were companies from Europe, Mr. Speaker. There were companies from the Caribbean, from the States, all over the world, Mr. Speaker, because these are builders who have technologies ready, who are looking for jurisdictions where there's a framework in place, Mr. Speaker, where they can build the kind of efficient homes and buildings that that they're capable of building. So they are very, very eager to do that work here in Ontario, Mr. Speaker. You know, and when the leader of the opposition talks about ideology, the ideology that we're fighting in this legislature is an ideology that says that climate change isn't a problem. Do nothing. Don't take action, Mr. Speaker. Don't look at the costs of climate change. Just sit on your hands. That's not what we're going to do, Mr. Speaker. We're moving forward.
Thank you. New question? The Leader of the Opposition.
Mr. Speaker, my question is for the Premier. Since I can't get an answer on sending $3 billion to California, let's talk about education. A Ministry of Education document reads, "Ultimately, a school's condition reflects the state of commitment of one generation to the advancement of the next." That sounds right. But if that's true, this government isn't making a very strong commitment to Ontario's students. Across the province, schools have fallen into disrepair. In fact, Ontario has a capital repair backlog of $15 billion. What kind of commitment is that? Mr. Speaker, how many more years will students have to learn and teachers have to teach in our crumbling schools? We must do better. Will the Premier commit to that?
Thank you
very much, Mr. Speaker. Well, I know the Minister of Education is going to want to comment, but I want to just assure the member opposite that we have been investing, we'll continue to invest in school upgrades, Mr. Speaker. Since 2003, $13 billion has resulted in nearly 755 new schools and more than 720 additions and renovations around the province, Mr. Speaker. And over the next 10 years, so the commitment going forward, Mr. Speaker, $11 billion to help build new schools and to renovate, Mr. Speaker. So that commitment is a real commitment, and you can look at the record of the building and the renovation that we've done in order to measure the impact that we will have going forward. $11 billion over the next 10 years, Mr. Speaker. We recognize that the condition of schools is very important.
Answer.
We'll continue to make those investments.
Chief Government Whip, come to order. Supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, back to the Premier. This government may believe that a $15 billion repair backlog is acceptable, and they justify it with their spin. But the reality is the government isn't doing enough. Just listen to what the grassroots organization Fix Our Schools had to say. Classrooms are 10 degrees to 12 degrees in the winter, are not an anomaly across this province. And in the spring and the fall, on a third floor of an old building, it wouldn't be uncommon to be in excess of 30 degrees, certainly not optimum learning conditions. Ceiling tiles are moldy and collapsing. That's from this grassroots organization. These conditions that set our children up for success? Absolutely not. We need to have the proper schools. Mr. Speaker, the Premier can't blame this on local school boards. Mr. Speaker, she was the former Minister of Education. Why has the Premier turned a blind eye to the state of disrepair of far too many of Ontario's schools?
Thank you. Premier.
Minister of Education.
Minister of Education.
Yes, thank you very much, and I'm pleased to respond to this question. You know, Speaker, we currently are in a $1.25 billion program over 3 years to address school renewal and school repairs. And in addition to that $1.25 billion that's specifically for school repairs...
Member from Renfrew, come to order.
In addition to that money, we actually also have a $750 million school consolidation fund, and what that helps us is it helps schools, school boards, to maintain the schools that remain open after a round of school closures. They can actually renovate, build additions, replace, renew. So the we've had a massive investment in school safety and condition.
Final supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, back to the Premier. The Minister of Education brags that they have a $15 billion problem and they're going to deal with 7% of it? 7%? How about all those students in those schools where there's mold and disrepair? Let me share a story. You know, there was a six-year-old child who received a concussion because she was going to the washroom in her school and the washroom door fell on her. Auditorium ceilings have collapsed during school hours, putting students at risk. John English Junior Middle School in Etobicoke is home to 900 students. The school is in critical condition and needs $20 million in repairs. Listen to what a student from Runnymede Public School had to say. Some kids have to wear their winter coats in class, while for others their classrooms are so hot it's hard to learn. Our bathrooms don't have locks, so they can't even have privacy. That's from a student. Mr. Speaker,
the member from Barrie, come to order.
Expect children to learn while they
shiver
and are forced to wear winter coats in the classroom. Will the Premier commit to dealing with the huge list, the backlog of $15 billion to fix our schools?
Minister.
Yes, thank you. And I mean, I must comment that if a hinge on a bathroom door needs fixing, then the caretaker should probably fix the hinge on the door. But let's talk. You mentioned schools in Toronto, so let's talk specifically about the Toronto District School Board. The school condition improvement allocation, which is based on average school condition in particular boards, has increased by four times. We've quadrupled the number from 29 million to 112 million. That's a massive increase. And we have directed every school board in Ontario to use the proceeds of disposition when they sell one school site to pay for the renewal and repair of their remaining sites, which actually gives school boards a significant cash inflow that they have control over.
Answer.
On their own. Thank you.
Thank you. No question. Third party.
Thank you much, Mr. Speaker. My question is for the Premier. The final report into the mercury contamination in Grassy Narrows was released publicly a week and a half ago. It says that high levels of mercury in Grassy Narrows Wabagoon River suggest there may be an ongoing source of mercury in the system. The government has had this report, Speaker, since April. Will the Premier tell Ontarians whether the government is aware of any sources of ongoing mercury contamination in Grassy Narrows?
Well, Mr. Speaker, I know the Minister of Aboriginal Affairs is going to want to comment, but I had the opportunity to attend the beginning of a meeting that the Minister had with scientists from the Minister of the Environment and Climate Change and from his own ministry, Mr. Speaker, with the Chief from Grassy Narrows, and so I had the opportunity to meet with the Chief and one of his colleagues. And, Mr. Speaker, we are very serious about looking at the recommendations in the report, making sure that we are doing everything in our power. And I had an opportunity to talk to Chief Fobister and to say to him that, you know, when I went to Grassy Narrows and I talked to the scientists about the mercury that's in the sediment in the lake and in the river, there was no, at that point, there was no knowledge of increased mercury or ongoing mercury poisoning, Mr. Speaker. If that is the case, we need to discover what that is, and we need to look at whether there are ways that it can be cleaned up,
Thank
as
you.
I said, without doing further damage.
Yep. Supplementary.
Well, Speaker, Perhaps the Premier can tell Ontarians then whether the government is actually monitoring the water in the Wabagoon River so they know definitively whether or not there is new mercury contamination in the Wabagoon River and Grassy Narrows.
Minister of Aboriginal Affairs.
And then Minister of Aboriginal Affairs.
Thank you. As the Premier has said yesterday afternoon, I and my Assistant Deputy Minister, scientists from the Ministry of the Environment and Climate Change, along with the Minister himself, Minister Murray, met with Chief Fulbester and some of his or one of his officials. We had an agenda of some five items on the agenda. This mercury pollution issue was obviously one of those agendas, items on the agenda. As a result of that meeting, I have committed to going to Grassy Narrows on June 27th. I will be accompanied by Minister Murray. We will be also accompanied by a number of Ontario scientists. And having spoken to the Minister of Health this morning, Minister Hoskins, he's rearranging or attempting to rearrange his schedule so he can
answer.
To Grassy Narrows also. We take this issue very seriously, and that's why the Premier and three
Thank
ministers
you.
Have met with the Chief and will continue.
Thank you. Final supplementary.
Speaker, to date, this Premier has refused to accept all the scientific evidence that shows that mercury in Grassy Narrows can be cleaned up. And in the meantime, Speaker, the people of Grassy Narrows and the children of Grassy Narrows First Nation continue to get sick and continue to worry. It is time to accept the truth, Speaker. It is time to begin some action on reconciliation. It has been decades. This government has been in power for over a decade. The question is, when will this Premier begin the cleanup of Grassy Narrows and the Wabagoon River?
Thank you. You see it, please. You see it, please. Thank you. Minister.
Minister Murray.
The Minister of the Environment and Climate Change.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. The report, the very good report that we received, talks about the need for an immediate field study. In addition to the ongoing monitoring that the scientists in the Ministry of Environment have been doing, both on fish and water. Minister Zimmer, Minister of Aboriginal Affairs, and I met with the Chief. We tabled a comprehensive 12-month plan for full field studies and to be able to determine how the mercury could be extracted without causing additional harm to people and to the environment. We agreed that the First Nations and the Chief Fulbester would make those decisions with the support of both ministries. As Minister Zimmer said, we
Answer.
Have a follow-up meeting with our team of scientists, and we will be up there working under the leadership of the First Nations, providing with them all the resources they need
Thank
to
you.
Properly action and solve this problem, Mr. Speaker.
New question? The Leader of the Third Party.
Thank you, Speaker. My next question is also for the Premier. For weeks, the Premier and her ministers have denied the crisis in health care instead of fixing it. Ontarians need health care that they can count on, not a press release, Speaker, not a commercial that says everything is fine. When will this Premier stop denying that Ontario's hospitals need more than $3 billion in critical maintenance and get on with the job of fixing the hospital, Speaker?
Mr. Speaker, you know, we recognize that there needs to be continuing and ongoing investment in health care. That's why there's more than $1 billion, Mr.
Absolutely.
Speaker, in our most recent budget, including $345 million for hospitals. That's why there's an $12 billion in 10 years. I'm getting the 12 and the 11 between education and health care, Mr. Speaker, because we're investing in both health care and education,
That's
Mr.
Right.
Speaker. So the
$12 billion over 10 years that we are investing in the bricks and mortar of hospitals, Mr. Speaker. We fully recognize that those investments need to be made. That's why we've made the commitment of the dollars, Mr. Speaker.
Supplementary.
Speaker, this Liberal government is in denial in terms of the mess that the health care system is in this province. If you take your loved one to a hospital, Speaker, you want to know that the medical professionals have the tools and the resources that they need to provide the care that they're trained to give. I met a nurse on the weekend who told me that her hospital was so under-resourced that she was concerned for her license and that the poor quality of care that she was forced to provide was causing her serious, serious mental anguish each and every day when she walked in the door after a shift. She actually had to quit her job, Speaker, to maintain her personal and professional integrity as a frontline nurse in a hospital. Now, when will this Premier stop denying that there is a crisis in health care and give frontline health care workers the resources that they need to provide the quality of care that they, that they deserve to provide and that patients
Thank you.
Health and long-term care.
First of all, long-term care.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And I know that the leader of the third party met a nurse this weekend. She met her at the OPSU offices in North Bay. She didn't bother to walk down the road to the hospital and actually visit the hospital, see for herself, talk to the hospital administration, talk to the staff working there at a hospital that has made exceptional progress in improving the outcomes of Ontarians in that part of the province. But, Mr. Speaker, we have on so many different measures. If we look at the Conference Board of Canada's 2015 health report, according to them, the health of Ontarians was not only viewed favourably amongst Canadian provinces, but it was evaluated by the Conference Board as the seventh best in the world, Mr. Speaker, placing ahead of Japan, ahead of Germany, ahead of the United Kingdom, and ahead of the United States.
Thank you. Final supplementary.
Speaker, I think it is disgraceful that a minister of this crown, a minister of this government that pretends to be progressive, continues to use unionization in a pejorative fashion in this House. Shame on that Liberal government, Speaker. Shame on them. Ontario's hospitals undeniably need more than $3 billion in critical maintenance. I've met nurses who have been fired from hospitals, Speaker, and I have met hospital.
Come to order. Please.
And I've met hospital administrators, speakers, CEOs of hospitals who have told me that they have been forced to close beds because of Liberal budget cuts. What this all comes down to, Speaker, is that patients who need care in hospitals are not getting the care that they need because hospitals are being cut. Instead of denying this crisis in health care, Speaker, when will this Premier step up to the plate and deal with the crisis that she has created?
Thank you. Minister.
Mr. Speaker, union representatives and their members know that this government has a deep and profound respect for them. We meet with them regularly. They help us develop positive and proactive policy decisions. But where I won't have it both ways, Mr. Speaker, is when the leader of the third party claims that 300.
Minister.
When the leader of the third party claims that 350 nurses and health care workers lost their job at North Bay Hospital, when in fact, since the amalgamation in 2011, there have only been 21 layoffs, Mr. Speaker. And where I draw the line is where she claims that 1,400 nurses lost their jobs last year, when the truth, Mr. Speaker, is that
leader of the third party, come to order.
1,000 nurses, according to the College of Nurses of Ontario, net new jobs were created.
3,000 jobs in the province.
The member from Renfrew, come to order. Second time. New question.
The member from Leeds, Scranton.
Thanks, Speaker. My question is for the Premier. This morning, the Auditor General tabled her special report on the Pan Am and Para-Pan Am Games. And despite the government's claims, the Auditor General's report confirmed that the Pan Am Games were neither on time nor were they on budget. In fact, the operating budget, and it's right here in black and white in the Auditor General's report, that contributed the Ontario government contributed significantly more dollars. In fact, $304 million, or 61% more. In fact, she also highlighted that the bundling of capital projects contributed to the project's delay and significant deficiencies. Shame. So we all know, Speaker, that the Pan Am lucrative bonuses were all tied to showing up for work.
Question.
But also they were shown to show for exceptional performance goals. They could have stopped this. They could have told them not to get this money. Why did this
government look
the other way? Here, here.
Thank you.
Thank you very, very much, Mr. Speaker. I want to take this opportunity to first thank the Auditor General for the report, and I want to thank the member opposite for the question. Mr. Speaker, on the very first page of the report, the Auditor General states, and I quote, "Ontarians can take pride in the fact that the 2015 Games went on without a major hitch." Mr. Speaker, she continues to say they left a legacy of infrastructure for athletes and the general public to use and led Canada to its biggest ever haul of medals for the Pan Am, Para-Pan Am Games. Mr. Speaker, these are high praises coming from the Auditor General. It doesn't stop there, Mr. Speaker. The AG states that the Games were, and I quote, "praised for their smooth operations by the Pan American Sport Organization and the America Paralympic Committee." She also highlights, Mr. Speaker, how all three levels of government, leveraged the Games, highlighted that the Games accelerated the West Don Lands by about 10 years. Mr. Speaker,
we are
so proud of these Games.
Thank you. Can you see it, please?
Supplementary, please.
The report is pretty clear. 61% over $304 million. Speaker, back to the Premier. In September, I asked the Minister to freeze the payment of
all bonuses
until the Auditor General finished her report. He answered by telling me these are the most transparent Games in the history of the country. And despite the minister's gloating, the auditor said she was unable to obtain answers to certain questions and could not obtain some documents she requested. The auditor wasn't able to access all computer hard drives. Hardly open and transparent for a government that has a shady history when it comes to hard drives. Speaker, what was the government hiding on these missing hard drives? Directives from the minister to not pay those lucrative Pan Am bonuses?
Thank you. Minister.
Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker. I'm proud of the legacy of the Pan Am, Para-Pan Am Games. And Mr. Speaker, the Auditor General speaks exactly about the highlights of this legacy for these Games here in Ontario. Mr. Speaker, we increased the number of trained volunteers here in the province of Ontario, and the Auditor General says some 23,000 people served as trained volunteers for the Games. A new volunteer website was introduced to link Game volunteers to future volunteer opportunities here in Ontario. The AG talks about how we encourage youth sport, stating that the Pan Am, Para-Pan Am Game Kids program also helped motivate children and youth to participate in sport in more than 4,250 sites, Mr. Speaker.
Member from Stormont, come to order.
The AG states the Games helped fund the completion of 250 kilometer stretch of the Trans-Canada Trails here in Ontario, which provides a continuous trail from Windsor to Ottawa, from Fort Erie to North Bay. Mr. Speaker, it's only the progressive Conservatives from the very beginning who didn't understand the power of these Games, and we are proud
as
a Liberal government.
Thank you. Be seated. Be seated, please.
New question, the member from Toronto Danforth.
Thank you, Speaker. Speaker, my question to the Minister of the Environment and Climate Change. Today, the government finally released its climate change plan. The plan is long overdue and much needed. But for this plan to sustain public support, it needs to be fair, effective, and transparent. Low-income, rural, and northern communities face a disproportionate burden. Climate change action will cost them more of their income than other Ontarians. They will need some extra help. But when you look at the percentage of total spending, this plan offers very little support for these communities. Why does this action plan offer so little support to low-income, rural, and northern communities?
Thank you. Minister of the Environment and Climate Change.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. I want to thank the member not only for his question, but for the very hard work he did on the bill. And nothing makes a minister happier than the environment minister when the critics said we should do more. There is over $1 billion, Mr. Speaker, of support for affordable housing and apartments and for single-family homes. In the north, this will be particularly powerful. As the Minister of Energy said earlier today, the savings, I believe, are in the range of $800 to $1,300 per home for rural and northern northerners through the types of programs that are available to them. We recognize that northerners don't have some of the choices that people in the south and large cities do, so we are putting disproportionately more money into those programs where the highest cost levels
Answer.
Are and where things like transit and energy choices are more limited, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Speaker, the NDP proposed that Ontario follow California's example by dedicating at least 25%, Minister, of cap and trade funds to programs that directly benefit low-income, rural, and northern communities who are facing a disproportionate burden. So notwithstanding what you've said, Minister, we don't see that 25% allocation. The government rejected our proposal. Instead, out of the $8.3 billion the minister wants to spend, northerners will get just $1 to $4 million to replace their wood stoves. It's the only explicit commitment to the north. How can the minister sustain public support for his climate change action plan when he won't address the unfair burdens carried by low-income, rural, and northern households?
Thank you.
Mr. Speaker, I appreciate the question again. So the member is reading from page 67 of the plan, and which is a dedicated program, he's right, that recognizes wood stoves. Right above it, it says, for all Ontarians, because we're one Ontario, $500 to $600 million for home retrofits and energy systems and that. Right underneath it, for near carbon incentive rebates, another $180 to $220 million. I would suggest, since the low income lens, unlike California, doesn't apply to a group of expenditures, but we have to demonstrate across all of our expenditures that we've met the equity test, that all monies can be applied in these situations. Northerners are eligible for all of this money. We're working through municipalities in the north, and we'll be working with municipalities to support existing municipal programs and add to those.
Thank you. Speaker.
Well explained.
New question, the member from Sudbury.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is for the Minister of Northern Development and Mines. Mr. Speaker, many people in Northern Ontario and in my riding of Sudbury are involved in the mining and mining exploration industry. Companies conducting mineral exploration are part of an important early step in the mining cycle, and it is critical to the success of the mining industry that the government support their development, Mr. Speaker. So last month, Mr. Speaker, I asked the minister about the Junior Exploration Assistance Program and what this government is doing to support Ontario's mining industry. I understand that recently the first round of the JEEP program closed and funding has been announced, Mr. Speaker. So, Mr. Speaker, can the minister please update this House on the progress of the Junior Exploration Assistance Program and how the government is supporting mineral exploration in Ontario?
Thank you. Minister of Northern Development and Mines.
Thank you so much, Mr. Speaker, and thank you to the member for Sudbury for that question. And as always, appreciate his great commitment to Ontario's mining industry. Certainly, our members, all members of our government, understand how the mineral sector is vital to our economy and to our future prosperity. That is why in December we announced an investment of $5 million through the Northern Ontario Heritage Fund Corporation to support this new Junior Exploration Assistance Program, or JEAP, delivered by the Ontario Prospectors Association to aid junior exploration companies to conduct or plan exploration work in Northern Ontario. We knew it was timely to support this. I'm very pleased that following the first round part of applications, I was pleased to announce that we were supporting 32 projects from 25 different companies for an investment of $2.7 million, something that was very welcome from all the junior exploration companies.
Answer.
And the may I also say the Ontario Prospector Association has announced that a second round of applications is now in the works.
Thank you.
Began May 30th, go to the end of August. Thank you.
Supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, and I also want to thank the minister for that answer. I know it's encouraging to see this government actively supporting the mining and exploration industry in Ontario, Mr. Speaker. And as the minister knows and mentioned, the mining industry in Ontario supports 26,000 direct jobs and over 50,000 indirect jobs. And it is important to note, Mr. Speaker, it is the largest private sector employer of Indigenous peoples in Canada. So, Speaker, I understand that in addition to supporting the mineral exploration companies and projects, the Junior Exploration Assistance Program and the Ontario Prospectors Association are providing resources for members of the public and Indigenous people who are interested in becoming prospectors. So, Mr. Speaker, can the minister please tell us more about the Prospectors Training Program and how this will
Question.
Help grow the prospecting industry in Northern Ontario?
Thank you, Minister.
Yeah, thank you so much again, Mr. Speaker. This is a great question. We need more prospectors in the province of Ontario. And later this summer, the Ontario Prospectors Association will be engaging in this new exciting initiative aimed at training new prospectors across Northern Ontario. We're working in partnership again with the OPA to deliver five-day prospecting training courses to members of the public interested in learning more about prospecting and possibly becoming a prospector. This supports our government's mineral development strategy and its commitment to educate, to recruit, and to retain a highly skilled exploration workforce in Ontario. They'll be working with geoscientists from the Ontario Geological Survey. Trainees, thank you very much. Trainees will develop such skills as rock and mineral identification and geological map reading. They'll also learn about what government programs
Answer.
Are available to assist them in their prospecting endeavors. Certainly, together with initiatives like this, the JEAP program we talked about earlier, we're going to be supporting a mineral sector that's
Thank
healthy,
you.
Innovative, and sustainable.
Thank you. New question, the member from Prince Edward Hastings.
Thank you, Speaker. My question this morning is for the Minister of Education. Minister, 2 days before most parents and kids were notified of the consultation process that was beginning for provincial and demonstration schools, the government held a secret meeting about the future of the demonstration schools. I've got a few questions for the minister this morning. Can the minister confirm if such a meeting was held on February 21st, yes or no? And was the only agenda item for that meeting, quote, an exit strategy to close demonstration schools in June 2017, yes or no? And if those were both things that did happen, why would this government spend $1.8 million on a consultation process when really the decisions had already been made to close these schools in June of 2017?
Thank you. Minister of Education.
Well, the reason we would have a consultation process is obviously that no decisions were made. We went out to consult. We recognized, obviously, that there are some issues around enrollment in our schools for the deaf in some cases. We realize there's issues around the number of children with severe learning disabilities that can be served by demonstration schools in the way that they're presently offered. There's only actually 160 children per year that can receive the programming all across Ontario that's offered for severe learning disabilities in demonstration schools. But were any decisions made prior to the consultations? Absolutely not. So that's why we had consultations.
you. Supplementary.
Speaker, back to the minister. This government's plan, or lack of plan, I guess, has caused chaos for these students, and it's caused chaos for the parents. It's caused chaos for the employees. That's why they're rallying again today outside the schools in Belleville and Milton and London and Ottawa at these provincial schools. The freeze on school enrollment during the consultation has forced these parents into limbo. They won't know until June 24th whether their children will be accepted into a demonstration school, and as a result, they're unable to tell their home school boards whether they'll have to deal with a student with a learning disability. Now we have kids with severe learning disabilities who don't know where they're going to go to school next year, and the schools, which are cutting millions of dollars in special education programming, don't have a place for them either. If the Premier doesn't fire this minister next week, she's doing all students in the province a disservice. Speaker, does the minister think it's appropriate that the students who need the education system most should have to guess about where they're going to school next year?
Shameful.
Minister.
Well, as the member knows perfectly well, the application process for students who are going to who wish to attend a demonstration school is ongoing. There's an application process for students who wish to attend demonstration schools every year. As I just mentioned, there are 160 places for students in demonstration schools throughout the province at the four demonstration schools. So there's an application process every year where students don't know until the spring whether or not they will be one of the students who's been accepted. My concern is that we have students all across Ontario with severe learning disabilities who actually don't have the sophisticated programs available that are available at the demonstration schools. And we don't think that you should have to apply.
Thank you. New question. The member from Hamilton East, Stoney Creek.
Mr. Speaker, my question is to the Premier. This morning, as you know, the Auditor General revealed the Pan Am Games went shockingly over budget. Ontario's original budget for the Games was $500 million. The cost so far is $804 million and climbing. That's 61% over budget. Speaker,
order.
This is almost at the levels of eHealth and Orange of Waste. Yet 7 months ago, Speaker, 7 months ago, the minister stood up and had the audacity to claim that the Pan Am Games had come in under budget. Speaker, enough is enough. We can't trust even simple arithmetic with this government. What is the Premier going to do to hold people accountable for wasting $300 million plus of provincial money?
Question. Thank you. Premier.
Minister of Tourism, Culture and Sport.
Minister of Tourism, Culture and Sport.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And I again want to thank the member for the question. Mr. Speaker, in 2009, there was a bid book. The bid book had $2.42 billion for the Games, the entire amount.
Correct.
Mr. Speaker, it was $47 million under budget by the time we reported it in our last technical briefing. Mr. Speaker, the Auditor General highlights the Games were so successful that, I quote, public attention to the Games also grew as the number of Canadian medals continued to be won. The CBC, which broadcast the Games in Canada, expanded its television coverage three times to respond to this demand, Mr. Speaker. So that wasn't once, twice, but three times, Mr. Speaker. That's because these Games were the most successful Pan Am, Parapan Am Games in the history of these Games.
Supplementary.
Well, Speaker, if I inflate the prices originally, I can come under budget too. Speaker, the incompetence is incredible. The incompetence. Let me quote.
Stop the clock. Stop the clock. Stop the clock.
Let me quote the report. The other funding partners for the Pan Am Games, the federal government, the municipalities, and the universities in a total contributed 96% of their 2009 commitment. So, Speaker, everyone else came under budget. but the government went 61% over budget. How can the Premier possibly excuse this? And to make matters worse, this is the piece de resistance, Speaker. The TO 2015 board decided last August to award full executive bonuses despite the interim figures were not being in and despite being fully aware that it had gone over the operating budget. Why did the Premier authorize some of the highest bonuses in history on the Sunshine List when she should have known that TO 2015 had spent over budget in light of the Auditor General's...
Thank you. Minister?
Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker. The Auditor General's report underscores that the governance of the Games was best in class. The AG states that the governance model was, and I quote, Mr. Speaker, a good model for multi- and cross-disciplinary projects like the Games, and that the governance led to the AG saying that, on an overall basis, TO 2015 exceeded its sponsorship targets by 29%. It also leads that the AG says that the vast majority of infrastructure projects, Mr. Speaker, came in at or under budget.
Like the stadium.
Mr. Speaker, everyone knows that the Games were a massive success. It boosted our GDP by $3.7 billion, created 26,000 jobs, and has left a legacy for all of us to be proud of. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. The member from Hamilton East Stoney Creek, please come to order. New question, the member from Barrie.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is for the minister responsible for women's issues. Minister, May was Sexual Assault Prevention Month, and we all know that sexual violence has a devastating impact on the lives of victims and their families. I find this unacceptable and do not believe that sexual violence should be tolerated in Ontario or anywhere else. It is important that we support survivors and work towards changing attitudes and behaviours that lead to such violence. This means changing the conversation and engaging Ontarians in a discussion about sexual violence, how to prevent it, and how to inspire behavioural changes. Minister, could you tell me how you are working towards changing behaviours that lead to sexual violence and fostering this discussion?
Good question. Thank you. Minister responsible for women's issues.
Thank you. I want to thank the member from Barrie for this very important question. And this is an extremely important issue, Speaker, and we must all work together towards solutions. So part of It's Never Okay, our action plan to stop sexual violence that we launched last year, established the Creative Engagement Fund, which is a $2.25 million investment over 3 years to support artistic projects that raise awareness and provoke discussion about challenging issues and sexual violence and harassment. These projects can include things like performing art, writing, music, photography, or murals, and traditional Aboriginal art. The artists and the art organizations will partner with sexual violence and harassment prevention organizations to ensure that their projects are informed by the experience of survivors and those working closely with them.
Answer.
These projects, Speaker, will start conversations and work towards engaging all Ontarians in discussion on ending sexual violence in our province.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker. Thank you to the minister for that response. I'm glad to hear that we are fostering awareness to support survivors. This confirms our government's commitment to ending sexual violence and working towards prevention. It's Never Okay states that we are establishing several methods to spread information and generate new ideas about how to end sexual violence. So I'm curious to know how these efforts are making a difference. I understand that recently the first recipients of the Creative Engagement and Innovation Funds were announced after a competitive application process. Speaker, could the minister tell us about these first recipients of funding from the action plan and how they are contributing to the conversation?
Thank you, Minister.
Thank you. Again, I want to thank the member for the question. So last month, Speaker, we announced there'd be 11 recipients through the Creative Engagement Fund, ranging in topics from consent, rape culture, gender equality, to challenging attitudes that actually cause sexual violence. I look forward to seeing the results of the work of the 11 recipients in the near future. And as mentioned, the action plan also established an innovation fund that's a $3 million fund with the intention of providing organizations with the means to create pilot projects like flexible employment programs, mobile support units, and bilingual intervention methods. This year, the innovation fund is supporting 7 projects across the province. They include projects on vertical farming, to provide flexible employment to survivors of human trafficking, research, and to provide support services for Francophone immigrant women and the development of technological tools for sexual assault survivors. Very important work.
Your question, the member from Wellington, Halton Hills.
Mr. Speaker, my question is for the Minister of Transportation. As the minister will recall, on January 20th, Town of Halton Hills Mayor Rick Bennett and staff, Regional Chair Gary Carr, and I met with him to discuss transportation issues in the Town of Halton Hills. At that meeting, the minister indicated that while the GTA West corridor study had been put on hold, he would have an update for us soon. That was almost 5 months ago now, which begs the question, how does the minister define the word soon? The uncertainty surrounding the GTA West corridor study is impacting the ability of the Town of Halton Hills to plan for the future. Our riding was opposed to Alternative 4-3, and we need to know where this is going. Will the minister explain the holdup, inform the House of the status of the GTA West corridor study, and tell us when he's going to be making a public announcement of what's going to happen next?
Thank you. Transportation.
Speaker, I appreciate the question from the member from Wellington Halton Hills. I remember that meeting that he asked for with his municipal partners from the municipalities in his particular area. It was a great meeting, Speaker. In fact, not the first meeting that I've had the privilege to take part in with that particular member, who is a very strong advocate, I will admit, of course, for his community, Speaker. As we said, I believe it was in last December when we were pausing the environmental assessment on this particular project, a project, Speaker, that began more than a decade ago. And I think every member in this House would recognize that the world of transportation and transportation planning has changed dramatically over the last decade, and I suspect will continue to change and transform in the next number of years and decades, Speaker. As soon as we have completed the review internally that's being undertaken currently, we will provide a public update, Speaker. Thanks very much.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Speaker, at the January 20th meeting, we also discussed the need to find a solution to the problem of truck traffic along Highway 7, including the possibility of an Acton bypass. There are serious concerns which have been expressed by the Town Council and residents about the ever-increasing truck traffic along Highway 7 in Acton, as well as in Georgetown and Norville. I share those concerns, and I tabled a resolution in this House last fall to draw attention to the problem. It's still on the order paper. The Town of Halton Hills has offered to partner with the MTO on a study to examine the problem and come up with a long-term solution. The Town has even offered to cover half the cost of the study. Will the minister commit to partnering with the Town of Halton Hills to carry out this study and work together with us to find a long-term solution?
Thank you, Minister.
Thank you very much, Speaker. I also thank the member for his follow-up question. I am always happy, and the Ministry of Transportation is always happy to work with members on all sides of this House and our municipal partners to find appropriate solutions to the challenges that we face. I know the Ministry, we're still having an internal discussion about that very specific funding support request from Halton Hill, Speaker. And again, as soon as we have an update with respect to that particular item, happy to share. While I have the opportunity, Speaker, I also once again congratulate that member and our members from Guelph and from the Hamilton area, because not that many weeks ago, Speaker, we did approve the Morriston Bypass, a significant infrastructure project in that member's community. Thanks very much.
Thank you. Your question, member from Oshawa.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is to the Minister of Education. This government continues to deny children with autism vital therapy while also cutting frontline education workers who help children succeed. Parents at the Toronto Catholic Board are concerned as the board is being forced to eliminate 56 education assistants. This government has cut over $500,000 to that board this year, making the problem worse. In Windsor, the public board continually faces a shortfall of nearly $5 million in special education funding. Government cuts to education leave school boards scrambling to fill gaps in service. Will this Minister of Education admit that forcing school boards to make decisions based on dollars and deficits is leaving students with exceptional needs behind?
Thank you. Minister of Education.
Yes, thank you very much, and I'm pleased to respond to the questions about funding for school boards, but I think we do need to focus on some of the facts. So, for example, from the Windsor Essex, the Greater Essex School Board in Windsor, their enrollment has gone down this year, and by the board's own calculation, they have a $700,000 decrease in
order.
Because their enrollment dropped. By the board's own calculation, they have 6,000 unutilized spaces. Wow. That is 6,000 seats. Wow. It's actually costing them $6 million a year to maintain those 6,000 unused
Answer.
Seats. So the idea that we've cut spec ed funding just isn't true. What has been cut is enrollment-based funding.
Supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Back to the Minister of Education. Ontario families know that when $8 million is cut from special education funding across 25 school boards and $1 billion in dedicated education funding goes unused over the past 3 years, their children are not a priority. At the Upper Grand District School Board, over $500,000 in cuts mean that the amount of time that education assistants can spend with students will be reduced. In Halton, the projected cumulative impact of special education cuts is $18.5 million over 4 years. Perhaps this minister can focus on facts and stop manipulating them. September is coming. September is coming. Thousands of students with autism will enter schools that do not have the resources to meet their needs. Speaker, why is this government balancing the books on the backs of students with special needs?
Minister?
So let's talk a little bit about special education funding. Since 2003, we have actually increased special education funding by 70%. We have increased it from $1.14 billion to $2.76 billion. We have not cut special education funding. That is one of the areas which has actually gone up most quickly is special education funding. She talked about the Toronto Catholic District School Board. It's had an increase of $3.3 million in special education funding. So we know that the idea that this party opposite promulgates that we're going around recklessly cutting spec ed funding is just not true. And what I can
Answer.
Say about the issue of autism is that we actually have a program called Connections, which when children are coming off of IBI treatment,
if Thank you.
To the school board.
New question, the member from Scarborough Asian Park.
My question is for the Minister responsible for Seniors Affairs. In June of each year, Ontario celebrates and recognizes contributions seniors make in our communities with many local events and activities across the province. Seniors are valuable members of our community through their knowledge, experiences, skills, and energy. In my riding of Scarborough Aging Court, I have a number of active seniors who participate in many programs like the Happy Caring Seniors Performance Troupe, hosted by the Golden Maple Leaf Seniors Associations, and the Villa Elegance Program promotes seniors staying active, healthy, and connected. Both of these community groups recently received funding from seniors community grants for their programs. Mr. Speaker, through you to the Minister, can he please inform the House about how Ontario's Senior Secretariat is supporting seniors through the month of June?
Minister responsible for Senior Affairs.
Thank you, Speaker. How refreshing it is to hear the member from Scarborough Aging Court speak so passionately about the seniors in her riding, Speaker. And I know that this is a sentiment that is expressed by every member of the House. Speaker, June 2016, it's the 32nd annual Seniors Month in the province of Ontario. to recognize the important role that our seniors play, Mr. Speaker. The theme for this year is seniors making a difference. Seniors not only make a difference, Speaker, but they enjoy doing what we have proposed to them with all the plans and activities that we are planning for the month of June. The month of June, Speaker, it's dedicated solely to the seniors. And OSS is involved in organizing so many activities, hundreds of activities in our province, Speaker. And I am very delighted to hear that Scarborough Aging Court is doing a lot of the events, and the member from Scarborough Aging Court is planning to attend in celebrating the seniors during the month of June, Speaker.
Supplementary.
I want to thank the minister for his response and for the work of the Ontario Senior Secretary providing for Ontario seniors. Minister, we know that by acknowledging seniors' contributions and how they are making a difference in our community, we are fostering a more age-inclusive society, a society that does not pit one generation against the other. During the Seniors' Month, as you said earlier, Minister, that I will be taking part in a number of seniors' events in my riding, including the official opening of the new Care First Centre, which has been providing quality care to seniors in Toronto and York regions for the past 40 years. Every day, Mr. Speaker, I hear concerns about many nonprofit groups regarding challenges in finding funds to operate their free community programs that keep seniors healthy and active in our community. Speaker, through you to the minister, can he please explain to the House what funding is available to community groups to support their seniors' programs?
What a great question.
Minister.
Speaker, I want to thank the member from Scarborough Aging Court again for the question. But let me say that it was the Premier's decide and her strong support for our senior that she wanted solely and a plan dedicated to our seniors in the province of Ontario. And I have to say, Speaker, that the Ontario Senior Secretariat staff has been very busy in sifting through another 700 applications this year alone. But seniors, the most wonderful thing is that the seniors organizations have embraced the call to the program, and so far we have had some 544 programs that have enjoyed activities in our province of Ontario, Speaker.
Answer.
So, the month of June, Speaker, again, this is a reminder to every member, we have celebration going to the province, and I would hope that the members will find the time to join the seniors and really tell them that...
No question, the members from Fallon Hill.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Last week, the Premier said that she wants to work with all parties in the House to create legislation to combat the BDS movement, which seeks to destroy the only democracy in the Middle East, Israel. As a member of the Jewish community, I am keenly aware that this movement is built on hate and lies. A few days ago, New York Governor Cuomo stood up to anti-Semitism by signing an executive order to ensure that those who boycott Israel get boycotted themselves. Sorry, that's Governor Cuomo. Will the Premier please tell us what legislation she is proposing and how it will be more than just words, legislation which will actually have the power to end the discrimination of anything associated with Israel and the Jewish community on our campuses?
Yeah. Mr. Speaker, well, I just need to correct the member opposite. I never talked about legislation, Mr. Speaker. I said we needed to work together with the opposition. Our government is a strong, strong supporter of Israel, Mr. Speaker. We always have been. We always will be. You know, that's why I was in Israel, strengthening and promoting our relationship and our trade ties, Mr. Speaker. I made a statement when I was there. I said that BDS is not the position of, it's not my position, nor is it the position of our government, Mr. Speaker. And it's unacceptable for students or parents or children to feel unsafe or to feel discriminated against wherever they are, Mr. Speaker, whether they're on a campus, whether they're in their communities, Mr. Speaker. So our government will never support a climate of fear or hostility. That's why we set up the anti-racism directorate, Mr. Speaker. We are absolutely clear in our position. I have made a statement, Mr. Speaker, and I stick to that statement.
The question period is over. There are no deferred votes. This House stands recess until 3 p.m. this afternoon.